Hi everyone, here Pull Out, the internet's busiest music nerd, and it's time for a review of the new Between the Buried and Me album, Colors 2. This is a brand new LP from the North Carolina metalcore and prog metal innovators Between the Buried and Me. Over 20 years as a band now, and almost 15 since the release of their seminal record, Colors, a game-changing album that pushed the possibilities of progressive metal and metalcore at the time. And while the following Great Misdirect wasn't exactly as envelope-pushing, it's still a great record, too. So up until this point, Between the Buried and Me is a group who I've mostly enjoyed the highlights in their catalog. Their output over the past 10 years hasn't excited me quite as much. As their music's grown more ornate and showy, I'm reminded of certain releases in the catalogs of, like, Dream Theater, Muse, or the Mars Volta that I appreciate for their virtuosity, but don't get a whole lot out of emotionally. And I was hoping with this new LP, the band sequelizing a classic in their catalog would plug back into that visceral but heady balance that made Colors so unique. But I think this LP falls massively short, despite what sounds like a whole lot of effort going into it. And you know what, that's not to say there's nothing good about this record, or that there aren't things that I think are impressive about this album. The performances are tight as hell, the production is clear as a bell, despite it being jam-packed with layers and details, and there are some really consistent lyrical themes flowing throughout the project too. But my main issue with Colors 2 is mostly that it undergoes a series of really unflattering and ill-conceived compositional and structural choices. Plus, this LP also feels like more of a continuation of the band's recent work than it does feel like something that's in the spirit of the album it's titled after. Take the opener Monochrome, for example. This is some heavy, crushing, just very downtrodden dystopian metal. The whole thing sounds like the world succumbing to a technological apocalypse. It's probably one of the most aesthetically consistent songs on the record. It's got some sweet changes though. All these elements of the track are good, but why, God, why is the song topped with these Christmas-ass synthesizers? It's like the world is coming to an end while Santa is delivering presents to it. Though from this song, we do get a pretty seamless transition into the following, the double helix of extinction, which seems to deal in the destruction of the planet and any natural or organic life, especially for humans. It's tragic, it's sonically crushing, it has the heaviness of metalcore, but also the technical tight and winding songwriting of a prog metal track, pretty much that Colors formula personified. That is until the band decides to hit us out of the blue with, like, air horn sound effects and a metal-fied Latin groove. Then some jazz fusion with really spooky lead melodies and low-key vocals. That does, in fairness, resemble at least, you know, a few moments on the original Colors record. And while that record was no stranger to some disorienting or, I guess, even head-scratching changes, this time around it feels more like the band is flirting with, like, this Patton or, you know, Mr. Bungle type zaniness, but they're not pulling it off with all that much flair. It never goes far enough or feels fully transformative. Case in point, the following track, Revolution in Limbo, which I enjoy the lyrics on this track. It's all about the monotony of modern life, but the flowery riffs along with the clean soaring vocals just kind of deal in Porcupine Tree and Muse levels of pretentiousness. The more frantic and explosive passages of the track do hit hard, but that is until we suddenly break into this gentrified Latin jazz rock passage that is about as spicy as Taco Bell. It sounds like if you took a Santana hit from the 90s and, you know, made it elevator music. Now, sometimes I do think this everything but the kitchen sink approach does work in the band's and the record's favor. There is the song Fix the Error, which in my opinion was an amazing teaser to the record. It had me really excited for it. The intro to this track is insane, with the wah bass and sour organs, as well as drums that are just like chugging along as if they're a runaway train. Then the whole thing lifts off into these really tight, propulsive passages of what feels like prog country jazz thrash. It's such a seamless blend of sounds, and they're mixed so creatively. It doesn't really matter what's going into it, I guess. All I know is the drummer is absolutely murdering it, and the whole thing flows together really cohesively despite there being so many radical shifts across the length of the song. Never Seen in Future Shock is another moment where the band's metalcore and prog metal influences weave together in that classic Colors type fashion. Plus, the way those riffs and drums sync together and hit with the synthesizers on top, it's gnarlier than like a Fear Factory track. But then at 2 minutes and 15 seconds in, I'm transported to what sounds like a Renaissance fair. It does come across a little Tull inspired if I squint at it, I guess. The band quickly transitions out of this though to deliver unto us a series of theatrical prog opera vocals and riffs. It does pick up the pace again at some point, but by the time the band is finishing the track off with more soaring vocals and some spoken word that runs kind of awkward, it all just feels a bit silly. The first Colors record was just so menacing in its execution and its performance and its aggression, and this just feels like, at times, a comedy of errors, or maybe a comedy of annoyances. I don't really remember Colors 2 being so convinced of itself as I was listening to it. Since at the time it dropped, it had something to prove. It was expanding the worlds of prog rock and metalcore before our very ears. Meanwhile, Colors 2 seems content to proclaim its glory to just its own cinematic universe by standing on the original film's shoulders and just adding some extra special effects. Boom, 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 boom.
Pew, 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 pew.
With the track Prehistory, the band delves into more general zaniness with even some cartoon sound effects. Matched with more doomsday messaging centered around visual media, I can kind of see the themes coming together, but it all still sounds too ridiculous to come off as serious. Sometimes it feels like the band is trying to hit upon something subversive with the musical equivalent to Pin the Tail on the Donkey. Bad Habits is another doozy in the track list, topping 8 minutes. The song is loaded with pretty righteous riffs and solos. It's not one of the most intense or explosive here, but it also doesn't go overboard for the sake of going overboard, I guess. Then there's The Future Is Behind Us, which has a really slick funk guitars, growling angular riffs, very rigid synth arpeggios, and flashy prog metal drumming. It's just about the most annoying thing on this LP. It just sounds like it's trying too hard to be weird, and it's trying to attempt weird through totally conventional means. Plus the synth funk breakdown in the middle of the track, complete with the chicka-chicka. I'm done. I'm over it. Look, with all hell broken loose, the real final hurdle on this LP is the 15-minute closer. Human is Hell. This track feels like at least a couple things to me. For one, it's like a bunch of ideas from the past hour that I have mostly checked out on already, so it's not like the song is really pulling out all the stops for a grand finale or anything. For sure, there are some blistering blast beats and prog metal passages around the midpoint, but as I listen to this, I can't help but think about just how gripping from end to end a song like White Walls is. Even Swim to the Moon, despite being a longer finishing cut, is more cogent in how it flows from passage to passage. Like, Human as Hell lacks that prolonged intensity, but also that lock you in place roller coaster relentlessness of both tracks, despite following clearly a similar formula. Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, this was a letdown for me. I feel like the band has presented us Colors 2 in name, but we haven't really got Colors 2 in spirit, at least for me, though I'm somebody who I guess is continuing to reckon with the fact that their sound has changed in a way over the years that I'm just not really a huge fan of, and I thought that Colors 2 might be a rekindling of something old, something familiar, something more classic, and while it is that to a degree, I would say to the extent that's true is to the extent that, you know, look, the band hasn't completely given up on their, you know, metalcore and extreme metal roots. I mean, those sounds have always been an undercurrent or a main role, depending on the track, on their material in the past 10 years. But yes, this record just doesn't really feel like a return to form or a return to much of anything like a sequel would, you know, imply. Feeling a strong 4 to a light 5 on this one. Transition, have you given this album a listen? Did you love it? Did you hate it? What would you rate it? You're the best, you're the best. What should I review next? Hit the like if you like. Please subscribe and please don't cry. Hit the bell as well over here next to my head. It's another video you can check out. Hit that up or the link to subscribe to the channel. Anthony Fantano, between the buried and me, forever.